Hi, Cameron.
Hi.
We're in the Julie Andrews Room, Prince Edward Theatre, and we are here to see Ain't Too Proud. Ain't Too Proud to Beg, or is it Ain't Too Proud?
Just Ain't Too Proud.
Ain't Too Proud.
If you want the full title, it's Ain't Too Proud, The Life and Times of the Temptations, but that's too long to say.
Ain't Too Proud, The Life and Times of the Temptations.
Yes.
Which really is an incredible charting of, I think, the most amazing group of all time.
Mm-hmm.
There'll be people who argue, but the people who argue will also have to admit that they're up there.
Oh, absolutely. It's one of the most iconic groups, I think, of all time, all music history.
Ain't Too Proud Company, please make your way to the stage. One of the producers is here to see you.
I know you wanna leave me, but I'll ask you.
Very excited to be here. The whole show is filled with just hit after hit after hit. My Girl is the one that really strikes a chord with me because my dad used to sing it to my mother a lot when I was young. So that one always feels like home to me. Mm-hmm. Right, and there are tons of music groups, as we all know, but The Temptations is, I think it's up there. I think it's in the top three,
mm-hmm.
inarguably.
Yeah, I think I've heard even the Beatles admit that. So, you know, that's where we're getting that. So you play Melvyn Franklin,
mm-hmm.
Melvyn Blue Franklin. Can you tell us a little bit about your character?
Yeah, so Melvyn is the bass of the group. Melvyn was, it's kind of an interesting history in terms of the lineup, but in terms of what we know as the classic five, he was the first, besides Otis, to join, to be a part of the classic five. Melvyn joined when he was about 15 or 16 years old. He was approached by Otis. They went to the same school together, but they didn't really know each other that well. And when you see the show, there's a funny encounter with that in terms of the meeting between Otis and Melvyn. But Melvyn is the bass of the group. He has been said to be one of the best bass singers of all time, which I absolutely believe. His sound helped really make the Temptations unique, because there aren't that many bass singers in general.
Mm-hmm.
Even though of that era, there were definitely a lot of bass singers who did doo-wop and soul and stuff like that. But yeah, Melvyn's the bass. His nickname is Blue.
Mm-hmm.
It's because he was really fond of that color, and funny enough, that's my favorite color too. So,
oh, wow.
It's really like uncanny how the parallels are.
What does it mean to you as a Black American playing? You know, you're quite young, so reliving that history every day. What does it feel for you?
You know, it's, I consider it to be an homage to really just my lineage, even though I'm not directly linked to Melvyn Franklin, but I remember growing up listening to Motown music and it being played on my father's record player and on the radio, of course, and just music of that era and that style. And I feel like it's always been a part of me. It's so important. So mm-hmm. getting to play this person every day and live and breathe Temptations music and that Motown sound that was created is really special. And I think it's really important to keep telling these stories, this history, this music history, because as we know, history can be forgotten. You know, so much is happening nowadays. And so it's really important to keep storytelling.
Mm-hmm.
You know, of course, it's in the past and a lot of the Temptations have passed away. A lot of the classic Temptations and others have passed away, but this group is still going.
Mm-hmm.
These are real people
mm-hmm.
as well.
The music has lived on with each generation.
Each generation.
Yeah. I actually think there are three types of Temptations fans.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So there's Temptations fans who know they're Temptations fans.
Yeah.
And then there are those who know the catalog and don't know they're Temptations fans. And then the third group must be living with that. Cave somewhere. They're just about to find out what the Temptations music
absolutely
is, and so they're just about to become fans.
Can I comment on those three mm-hmm. groups of people? There are people of all ages in all three of those groups.
Right.
I remember I came out of stage door. This may have been like the second week of performances, right? And there was this little boy and his mother. I found out that they were from Idaho, of all places. They live here now, but they were originally from Idaho. And this young fella said to me, like, I love Temptations music. He probably was somewhere between, 7 and 11 or 12 years old. I just thought, see?
Yeah.
It didn't just stop with my generation. I'm a millennial, by the way. It keeps going.
It keeps going. Because a lot of times you don't realize how many of the new artists have been influenced by the Temptations and keep singing those songs. But it's interesting how, what struck me actually in learning more about the Temptations in preparation for this interview was, at first I was thinking about the sparkle, even like, just what am I going to wear to this house city? I have to find something for my Christmas wardrobe, something sparkly. But then the more you dig in, the more you realize actually what was portrayed on stage, the glamour and that beautiful music that, you know, just made us all want to fall in love was not the case for them, right?
Very troubled stories, each and every one of them.
Mm-hmm.
Even the members that, you know, we don't get to tell in the story. I mean, you got to think about the times that these gentlemen grew up in, and became stars. And even though they became really successful, from the start, you had to deal with real life.
Mm-hmm.
You know, these men's families migrated up from the deep South, right? Mm-hmm. And I mean, I can't assume that everyone knows about Black American history, but to say it simply, they went through crap.
Mm-hmm.
Their families went through hardship, and so they all moved up to Detroit to have better lives, right? And of course, they did experience some, but there was still segregation and discrimination that happened. And even as they became stars, they still had to face it in their own country.
Right. I think that's something that I'm still trying to understand, is for myself, even just learning about racism and the differences of how things played out in America and, for example, how it is over here. I think it's something that will take, almost you have to do a PhD to understand it, really. I was listening to Otis actually recently speak about a moment when they were able to tour Carolina, I think. And he talks about how they come to the theater, they're excited to put on a show, and they see a rope right in the middle where the audience was split into white and black. And he talks about that moment and says how badly they felt, but they still had to perform. But he says the next year when they came, black and white were mixing, high-fiving, singing along. And he says, if you could see our faces and look beneath the sweat, you would have seen us crying. And every time I heard him say that, I watched that clip maybe 2-3 times so far. And every time I just kept hoping that I wouldn't tear up in, you know, when we were talking about this, because just to actually hear him today talk about what they lived through, and then see, because a lot of times we look at bands and we look at the successful people, like the Temptations were really successful, or just when they're starting to become successful, they self-sabotage, right?
Yeah.
And I think that's what I love about musical theater, is it's not just a concert.
No.
You experience the music, but you're actually able to experience a different time, a different period in history, and come out having an understanding for yourself, right? So what is this character teaching you?
Oh, you know, the main thing about Melvyn that I've learned from people who have experienced him, to the book, as we call it, the script, if you will, is that Melvyn always thought about the group.
Wow.
He considered everything, even the challenges that happened interpersonally, as well as, you know, between the group and the establishment, if you will, you know, the record execs and the managers and even, you know, government when it came to performing in the States. Everything was considered for what could be better for the group.
Wow.
Mm-hmm. He was so selfless.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the main thing that I've learned.
Mm-hmm.
And it's actually helped me, because, you know, we, the five of us, especially, there's more of us than just five, but the five of us spend so much time on stage together, right? And even so much time off stage.
Mm-hmm.
And that can be hard. You know, we've seen, mm-hmm. we've seen 3, 4, 5 person bands, groups, and just dealing with even that small amount of people in some sort of limelight can be very challenging.
Mm-hmm.
And so always thinking, okay, what's going to be better for us yeah. versus me?
Right. Isn't that
hard? Oh.
Yeah. Just overcoming your ego in that way, right? But, and how do you do that as an artist? Because you all have this thing, this drive to be seen. You want your voice coming out. You want to be able to help us all feel what we're feeling and to be able to synthesize what we're going mm. through. And so you have to hang on to your voice, right? But here's a group where one person at one point is the center and everyone else is supposed to feed into that. But yet this person is going to be the one who's most recognized. How do you, what have you learned? How do they deal with that?
This is a multi-layered thing, right? So we often talk about this. Each and every one of them, every five of them is so integral to the group.
Mm-hmm.
If you take one out, suddenly something's off.
Right.
Even if it's just Otis singing background vocals. Otis rarely had a solo moment.
Mm-hmm.
Melvyn might have had 2 solo moments
mm-hmm.
that we can at least find in videos and in catalog, you know?
Mm-hmm.
But bringing it back to Melvyn, like, if you take Melvyn out, suddenly it's a different sound.
Yeah.
It taught me that my voice,
mm-hmm.
both as a singing voice and just my voice as a person,
yes,
is just right.
Mm-hmm.
In terms of the storytelling in the book,
mm-hmm.
in the script, I don't have much to say,
mm-hmm.
but I'm present always.
Mm-hmm.
And even just being there
mm-hmm.
means a lot.
Wow.
Sometimes you don't even have to say a word, but you being there
mm-hmm.
shows your importance. It shows that you matter.
Mm-hmm.
And there's so much gravitas even in silence sometimes.
Right. That's something we can all learn, right?
Hello.
That's something we can all learn. Because a lot of times we feel like you have to shout, you have to stand out, you have to, you know, be something you're not. But in a way, when you look at actually Otis today, and he didn't, you know, he didn't succumb, that mm-hmm. resiliency, him having this love and this drive to actually push forward and do this group, and then meeting Melvyn and nurturing me, because they were like brothers, right?
Yeah.
And so that love seems to have transcended time and made an impact that even him, to this day, it seems to me, just watching him from interviews, he can't quite understand how he's the last surviving member. The story where he talks about the rope, he says he's fortunate enough now to live through another moment in history where he was just backstage and someone said they have to see him. And so the manager brings this audience member in, and it turns out it was a little boy who was made to put the rope down. And he said, I knew even then I shouldn't do that. And it was just, it shows you that things come full circle, right? I mean, and for me, just thinking about, like, even Melvyn,
mm-hmm.
thinking about what, because he had a lot of health challenges,
mm-hmm.
and looking at all these different group members, how did that the stressors of that time manifest into their health problems, into the ways it affected their relationships. I mean, I don't want to say too much. I don't want to.
Yeah, really, you know, I want to show. Find out.
Yeah. The good thing is we don't want to leave people with the challenges. What's special about this is the way they were able to take pain and transform it into magic on stage, so that everyone who's experiencing it can cast almost our own issues and leave it just in experiencing that.
That's the magic of music. Mm. The magic of music, which has turned into the magic of theater. Mm-hmm. It's said in the musical, you know, Melvyn gave his all till he could no longer. Melvyn was the last of the classic five to pass away. And, you know, I look at videos, because now there's a whole bunch of videos on YouTube, which you can also look at. And it really helped me in terms of performance style and really capturing the essence of Melvyn. Melvyn was always a light.
Mm.
He was very animated, very camp, actually, in his performance style. But, and then learning about the health challenges that he faced later on, towards the end of his Temptations career, and seeing what I see in video, it amazes me to know that he was going through so much physical pain and still able to perform. And that was probably some sort of therapy for him, in a way. Able to perform and give people what they need, want, love, until his passing. It's heartbreaking, but it's also beautiful. And it again speaks to the selfless nature of Melvyn Franklin.
I think the music, I've been thinking about why this music is transcending time, space. Like, I know people who can't speak English, who will force themselves to break the words.
Yes.
And so when you look at that, it is because music has that energy, right? That and love is never lost.
Mm-hmm.
And so, even again, not wanting to give away too much, but they didn't have the most successful romantic relationships, right?
No.
These people who wrote songs like Just My Imagination and My Girl.
Yeah. I mean, so many love songs.
Yeah.
So many love songs.
Only love songs. Like, stuff that you wouldn't just sing to a romantic partner, but you'd sing to your daughter, you'd sing to your sister, My Girl. So how do you think it says a lot about the human spirit that someone who's in so much pain can perform something so beautifully loving? What can you explain that to those of us who are non-actors?
I think that, you know, even though they didn't have, you know, what we would consider to be success and love and relationships, I think that one and that desire was always there. And I think that really helps drive the passion and then drive the performance. When the want is there and you're either yearning or still seeking for love, that's what makes these love songs in particular so poignant and so rich.
Mm-hmm.
You might not have had it, you know, in the palm of your hands at that moment that you're performing it, but the thought, the feeling, the hope
of finding love
or loving, you know, it still lives, and that helps. You know, all of us who perform on this stage, some of us are single, some of us are married, some of us are dating, you know, some of us have children, some don't. So we all have different experiences when it comes to love and relationships.
Mm-hmm.
But I bet you each and every one of us on that stage has at some point wanted to love or wanted to be loved. Absolutely. And so those things help.
Mm-hmm. That is the human, you know, people talk about the human condition, but really it is our longing and our need to love, right? And be loved. So let's talk about these members and the fact that they were, you know, able to live on as icons in our minds. So, like, one of the Temptations, they were close with the Supremes.
Yes.
And it's just interesting to see how I'm trying to think of how I can do this without giving away too much of the show, because you want to leave these moments of surprise for the audience.
Yes, please.
So what are other things that you can tell us about the show that wouldn't give away too much?
Be really strategic with this. So we do come into contact with other Motown artists. But of course, it's mostly the Temptations. The most that we come into contact with are the Supremes, of course. Mm-hmm. And I believe that the Supremes are in this story for a number of reasons. We don't get too much into the romantic connections between Temptations members and Supremes members, but it's there. Mm-hmm. That probably will require a whole different musical. but the main thing is to show that, one, the Supremes were successful first,
mm-hmm.
in Motown, and of course, just globally, mm-hmm. I think they were the first Motown group that really made it big,
mm-hmm.
with everyone.
Mm-hmm.
And it took the Temptations a little bit longer. So, you know, it really shows those challenges that the Temptations went through of getting a hit,
yes.
really, which is just so hard.
It's so hard to believe a group that the most successful group was actually at one time not known for being successful. Nobody thought they could, right?
No, it's crazy. Another layer to that is how the Supremes were able to, how the Supremes were able to be loved by white people,
mm-hmm.
all right, mm-hmm. and not just by black audiences. And that, for a lot of artists, regardless of how that might have made you personally feel, that was a goal, because you want to be globally successful.
Mm-hmm.
And so someone, I won't say who, of the character-wise, makes a comment about that.
Mm-hmm.
And it reminds you,
mm-hmm.
of the racial history of the country, I mean, frankly, of the world.
Mm-hmm.
And what certain
we always groups, like to put it on America,
exactly, right? But it's the world. It's not just the States.
Exactly.
It reminds you of what groups had to do to be commercially successful.
Mm-hmm.
What black artists, I should say, had to do to be commercially accepted,
mm-hmm.
and what that means is accepted in the eyes and ears of white audiences,
mm-hmm.
And what that meant for music production and music writing. And It still happens today,
mm-hmm.
you know, mm-hmm. pop versus soul.
Mm-hmm.
So that kind of, that discourse is touched upon
mm-hmm.
in a very clever way, I think. What else can I tell you? I mean, of course, you know, it's not just the classic five that are featured.
Mm-hmm.
You have the original five, the classic five, which is the most popular that people know of. And of course you have the new five, which includes Dennis Edwards. So this is when Dennis Edwards replaced David Ruffin.
Mm-hmm.
And so that's a whole different dynamic.
Yes.
That showed the tension between us all, and things start to break down. So yeah, I'll leave that again.
There's so much that we as the audience can take away, which is why I love interviewing you know, actors in musical theatre and really focusing on musical theatre, because mm-hmm. I'm always thinking, what can we take in, especially at this time, you know, this cost of living, a million shows to watch.
Mm-hmm.
And so the reason why I think to watch this show, Ain't Too Proud, is number one, the music.
Yeah.
You know, you want to go to a concert and know the lyrics and sing mm-hmm. along. That's the first entertainment. And then the second thing is to be able to take a story and then see, actually, what can I learn? The fact that most of us now know a little bit about how our own egos work, especially those of us who are spiritually inclined,
mm-hmm.
we're all, you know, trying to, we know how the ego functions in our own lives. And sometimes seeing entertainers and artists and people who put themselves out there and seeing them living out their lives, achieving the things they need to achieve and then not healing from their own pain helps us deeply reflect on our own lives.
Mm.
And so what are things that we can take away in terms of like healing from this show?
The first thing that comes to mind is that music heals, helps, it unites.
Mm.
I mean, you mentioned, you know, people don't even speak English, and you know, we have loads of audience members who come from all over the world. Mm. Different cultural experiences, and I've just learned that our show and the music especially, and you know what, even the story, every single person can take something from it. It's not just Black people, not just American people, mm-hmm. not just people of that era.
Mm-hmm.
Everybody can take away something from it. Whether that be a moment of harmony that between the five of us that we sing, that somehow just it can pierce you and make you cry or make you really happy. I see a lot of people have nostalgic moments. I look out into the audience, especially during My Girl when that's being performed, and I see couples, and automatically I'll see a couple just grab hands, and I guess that's transported them back to maybe a first date. I don't know, something.
Mm-hmm.
I see people who might have never heard of most or any of these songs,
mm-hmm.
and they're sat there and wonder as to, goodness, what is this?
Mm-hmm.
This is amazing, or this is heartbreaking, or this is intriguing.
Mm-hmm.
I've heard people leave the theater saying, I had no idea about X, Y, and Z.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't know that happened. That really happened.
Mm-hmm.
And some of these might have been Temptations fans.
Right.
Fans of the music. But like you said, no, not everybody knows the story, and no. So we really dive deep into that. So you can take away so much from the show.
Yeah, I think what entertainers show us is our own lives. You can still put on your best, still try every day and not give in to despondency, mm. not look at the world and feel hopeless, because you look at these people who triumphed over so much hardship.
Right.
And were able to, for a moment, just put aside everything and create something. And so, when it comes to you, I heard that you're going to Rotterdam.
Oh, yeah. I'll be performing in a concert in Rotterdam on the 8th of September.
Right.
At the Doula, the concert hall in Rotterdam, with the Rotterdam Philharmonic Orchestra.
Wow.
Yeah. So the concert is called Someday We'll Find Us. So I'll be singing a few Sondheim songs, and there are two other singers who will be performing other songs as well from different composers and artists.
Amazing.
So yeah.
For how long?
Just one night.
Oh, yeah, wow. Yeah, one in night. September.
September, Friday the 8th of September in Rotterdam, yeah.
Incredible. I didn't know anything about classical music, but my daughter suddenly picked up instruments and is really into it. And so I'm having to go to classical concerts for mm-hmm. the first time as a grown woman. And it's just, it feels like, you know, somebody who meditates a lot,
mm-hmm.
it feels like transcendent. Have you always been interested in music?
Yeah, I grew up around music, and I grew up exposed to not just soul and jazz and R&B, but also opera and orchestral music. I actually studied classical voice in uni. I studied opera. So that's also a part of me.
You always knew that music was going to be your future?
Yes. Once I learned that it could be a career, absolutely.
But what did you see for yourself? Have you been able to envision, manifest anything that as a child?
I just always saw myself performing. There was nothing very specific. Oh, I wanted to see. I think I remember thinking, oh, I want to be at Lincoln Center, which is in New York City, or Carnegie Hall, or like on Broadway or whatever. But I learned quickly that those aren't the end all be all mm-hmm. of performance places.
Mm-hmm.
And once I was opened up to Europe, and not even just Europe, South America, and
the world.
The world.
Yeah.
I realized, I could perform anywhere. Mm-hmm. And then, I mean, this is a long story, but like just life led me to Europe and led me to performing in different countries around the continent. And suddenly I'm in the United Kingdom. I've been here for 8 years now. And I don't even think I dreamt any of this as a kid. I knew I wanted to perform, and I knew that was
you'd follow that wherever it leads.
Whatever type of performance, whether that be singing, acting, dancing. Mm-hmm. And I just really I follow the wind. Sometimes it changes. Sometimes it's a gust of wind that goes, oh, no, you try this.
Mm-hmm.
And next thing you know, I'm
wow, it must be so it must be so amazing to have that attitude, because I think for most of us now, we, you know, if you are trained to think, oh, you know, you're going to go to school and you're going to be, you know, you're going to do a degree and this is how your life will unfold. You'll have 2-3 kids and this and that. And then life doesn't turn out like that for you.
Mm-hmm.
It's actually really hard to scratch that blueprint and go with the wind, like you say. So it's quite helpful that you have this natural way of being.
Yeah. Even in the arts industry, there can be a lot of kind of rule books as to what you should do, how you should do it, and when.
Mm-hmm.
And it's hard in an industry where you're always auditioning. Nothing's ever guaranteed. Nothing's ever forever.
Mm-hmm.
So, of course, you want to find some stability.
Mm-hmm.
And I've gone through those periods. Chapters and periods of my career, especially a decade ago when I was in my 20s. But like now,
mm-hmm.
now that I'm in my 30s, well into my 30s.
Wow.
I know.
I think we need a whole new like skin routine and all of that stuff.
That's a different episode. Now that I'm in my 30s and I know more of who I am and what I want for myself, not just career-wise, but as a human being, I'm able to go, okay, I want to try that.
Mm-hmm.
I want to explore these different things. And that still makes me an artist.
Mm-hmm.
It won't, you know, me trying a different genre won't take away from a previous genre of art. So I'm in my exploration era.
Wow, amazing. Yeah. And so that, do you think for just people who want to be a little bit more like that, you would say, look, just go with every chapter of your life. And sometimes it's going to be really hard to shed those. It's going to be tough, right? It's not easy for anyone. Because
yeah.
most people think, oh, you're an artist. You artists are malleable anyway. No?
I mean, I can't speak for all. Some of us aren't. And some of us can't afford to.
That's true.
To try different things all willy-nilly.
Mm.
So there's no rule book. Mm. There's no rule book. Everybody is an individual.
Mm.
And there's a place for everyone. There's a lane for everyone.
Right.
And if you stay in your lane,
mm-hmm.
however that lane may be paved,
mm.
some lanes are like this, some are like this, and then, you know.
Yeah.
But know that it's yours and stay in yours and don't look over to the next lane and go, oh, well, they're going this fast
no.
and straight. The minute I realize don't I can't do that,
yeah.
That'll be the danger.
Right. And do you think, staying on the insecurity thing, most people, you know, we all need that stability of knowing, okay, you're able to pay your bills and that's actually a lot of times chasing that stability is what clouds out most people's ideas about what they actually want to be doing in their lives. I don't know if you saw this, but I heard even Patti LaBelle had a moment like that. I know Patti had a sort of relationship with Otis.
It's not in the show.
But I can talk about this. So he wanted Patti LaBelle to give up singing. And That just shows you that you have to have that, you can't let go of that voice that says, you know what, if it's a choice between I'm going to be Otis's wife or I'm going to be Patti LaBelle, how can everyone, what is that that you all have that we all don't seem to, that helps you constantly think, yeah, this is who I am and this is what I want to bring out into the world?
Ooh, that's tough. I don't know if I know. So it's something. It's really like a je ne sais quoi type of thing. Like passion, drive, I guess, are the easiest words to think of. But I think there's something that is divine, metaphysical, whatever you believe, that drives us. Because, listen, the industry is hard. It's hard. It's glamorous, yeah, but it's hard. It's challenging. It's forever changing. And because, okay, I'm getting off something. Because it's always moving and changing, something has to be constant. You have to have a good foundation within yourself to survive this industry. Otherwise, it'll take you along for the ride, and you'll be like, oh my gosh, what's happening? And so when you have that foundation and that self-worth, then you'll be able to make the right decisions. And the right decisions are what you feel here. It's not what's in a rule book that doesn't exist. It's not what other people even suggest. Other people can have wisdom and suggest things, but ultimately it's what you feel.
And what do you think? Do you have practices? Do you have things that when you get all cloudy, when you get those cobwebs, do you have practices that retune you back into yourself?
Meditation, being in silence, because it's a very noisy world and noisy industry. And so taking time to myself, writing, journaling, those are the main things.
What are other characters you want to play?
Oh, gosh. I mean, Hades in Hades Town, another deep voice character. When I'm older, maybe Mufasa and Lion King.
Oh, nice.
There are a lot of characters. A lot of characters that when I get older and maybe look older, I want to.
Amazing. And besides, is it theater really, or do you also want to do film?
Everything.
No,
I'm not placing any limits on myself. I'm not saying I can do all and I'm omnipotent. But if the opportunity comes, I will definitely explore it.
Amazing. Cameron, it was such a pleasure to have you. And I can't wait to see the show myself.
Yes.
And I think all of you should definitely go out and buy some tickets. You're here until January?
Yes, the 7th of January, 2024.
Yeah. So catch it in the summer, autumn,
and winter.
And it's such a beautiful theater.
Yes, it
you
is.
You get dressed up, you know, feel like you're in the 20s or a more glamorous time. Right?
Come as you are, really. You'll enjoy yourself, guaranteed.
I know you wanna leave me, but I refuse to let you go. If I have to beg and plead for your sympathy, I don't mind kissing me, there must have been too proud to bear. It's you know it. Please don't leave me, girl.
Don't you go.
Ain't too proud to prove me, baby, baby. Please don't leave me, girl.
Don't you go.
Now I heard a crying man is hell for men with no sense of pride. But if I have to try to keep you, I don't mind waiting. If it'll keep you by my side, ain't too proud to bear.